Have you ever wondered how doctors figure out if you have an autoimmune disease? Well, physicians that are autoimmune experts rely on some amazing detective work and the presence of certain tests that we call autoantibodies. Today, I'm going to dive into the fascinating world of autoimmune diseases, and I'm going to explore the top 10 autoantibodies that rheumatologists use to crack the code.
rheumatologistoncall.com.
What are autoantibodies? Autoantibodies are antibodies produced by the immune system that mistakenly target and attack the body's own tissue and cell. Antibodies are proteins, which are produced by specialized white blood cells called B cells in response to a foreign substance, like a bacteria or a virus, and those are known as antigens. Now, in autoimmune diseases, the immune system fails to recognize certain self-antigens as self, and instead starts producing autoantibodies that target healthy tissues and cells. The autoantibodies can cause inflammation, damage to the organs and tissues, and it will disrupt the normal body function. Autoantibodies are specific to different autoimmune diseases, and they can be detected through blood tests. Let's talk about the most common types of autoantibodies that we rheumatologists, including myself, will use to get the diagnosis. Antinuclear antibodies, or ANA test. The ANA test serves as an introduction in the world of autoimmune diseases. Many patients are referred to my practice, or they contact me when they receive a positive ANA test result. By detecting these antinuclear antibodies, your doctor can uncover a potential autoimmune disease. However, it's important to take a deep breath and not jump to conclusion if your ANA test is positive, because this test alone is not enough to diagnose lupus or another autoimmune disease. Additional tests and a thorough clinical evaluation is always necessary. In one of my other videos in my channel, I dwell deeper into the ANA test and I discuss other conditions that can result in a positive ANA test. It's important to understand that a positive ANA test can be seen in various situations, including chronic infections like hepatitis B, C, HIV, certain medications such as acne medication, certain antibiotics, and antihypertensive medication. Other factors such as exposure to radiation or radiation therapy, prior history of cancers or lymphoma, and even in some cases, healthy people can have positive ANA tests. Instead of turning to Dr. Google, I encourage you to reach out to your doctor or my practice rheumatologist on call for further evaluation. If you want to learn more about the ANA test, I invite you to watch this video in my channel where I provide additional insights. Anti-double-stranded DNA antibodies. Anti-dsDNA or anti-double-stranded DNA are antibodies or autoantibodies that target double-stranded DNA, which is the genetic material found in the nucleus of cells. These antibodies are specific to systemic lupus erythematosus, or SLE, which is a very complex autoimmune disease. However, these antibodies can also be seen in other autoimmune diseases and can be induced by certain medications, like blood pressure medications. The presence of anti-double-stranded DNA antibodies in the blood is considered a hallmark feature of SLE and is included in the diagnostic criteria for this disease. If you are diagnosed with lupus based on this test and many other criteria that are needed for diagnosis, these antibodies need to be monitored periodically as they can indicate that your disease is becoming active. If the titer of dsDNA antibodies are increasing, then this is an indication that the lupus is active and can potentially damage organs like your lungs, heart, kidneys, and even your brain. Especially for people that have kidney involvement, the anti-double-stranded DNA antibodies are needed to be monitored at least every 3 months, along with other tests like your cell counts, comprehensive metabolic panel, complement levels, and your urine analysis. Anti-Smith's antibodies. Lupus has a special feature, and it's called the anti-Smith's antibodies. These autoantibodies target a specific set of proteins found in the cell nucleus called the Smith antigen. Anti-Smith's antibodies are highly specific for lupus, but they are found only in 25% of lupus patients. Their presence in the blood is considered a significant marker for lupus and is included in the diagnostic criteria for this disease. While not all individuals with lupus will test positive for anti-Smith's antibodies, their presence is highly indicative of lupus, particularly in the presence of lupus-related kidney disease or lupus nephritis. If they are absent, it doesn't mean the diagnosis of lupus is excluded. This type of autoantibodies are rarely found in other autoimmune diseases. Anti-RNP antibodies are also called U1-RNP. These U1-RNP antibodies are seen in patients with lupus, systemic sclerosis, and mixed connective tissue disease, but they are not specific to only one of these diseases. Now, patients that have only this type of antibody positive and none of the others might have mixed connective tissue disease. MCTD, or mixed connective tissue disease, is a unique blend of autoimmune conditions. Now, imagine an autoimmune condition that's a mix of lupus, scleroderma, myositis, and other disorder. That is MCTD. SSA and SSB antibodies. Have you heard of Sjögren syndrome? The SSA, or raw, and SSB, LA, antibodies are often found together in patients with Sjögren syndrome, but they can also be seen in other patients, like patients with lupus. Sjögren syndrome is an autoimmune disease that was initially recognized due to eye and mouth excessive dryness. This is another disease that I am passionate about, and like psoriatic arthritis, it's not recognized easily and many times is not treated appropriately. Many patients may have symptoms such as headaches, tingling, numbness, shortness of breath, among others, and they are disregarded for many years. If you check my YouTube channel, you're going to find out that I have posted many educational videos that are very well received by patients. Feel free to share my videos for more people to understand and find answers to their questions. SCL70 antibodies. SCL70, also known as anti-topoisomerase 1 and anti-centromere antibodies, are two specific types of autoantibodies associated with systemic or limited forms of sclerosis or scleroderma, which is another type of autoimmune disease. Now let's start talking about SCL70 antibodies. These autoantibodies, they target a protein called topoisomerase 1, which is involved in DNA replication and repair. These antibodies are primarily associated with systemic sclerosis, also known as scleroderma. Systemic sclerosis is a chronic autoimmune disease, which is characterized by fibrosis or thickening of the skin, but it can involve internal organs, especially the lungs, gastrointestinal tract, and even your heart. The presence of SCL70 antibodies in the blood is considered a specific marker for systemic sclerosis, particularly in a subset of patients known to have diffuse systemic sclerosis. These antibodies are often associated with more severe disease, more severe widespread skin involvement, and lung fibrosis. Anticentromere antibodies. Now let's talk about anti-centromere antibodies, because this type of autoantibodies, they target specific protein found in the centromeres of the chromosomes. These antibodies are primarily associated with a subtype of systemic sclerosis, which we call limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis, formerly known as Kress syndrome. This type of disease presents with skin involvement limited to the hands, face, and lower arms, as well as other features such as calcinosis, which is deposits of calcium in the skin, Raynaud's phenomenon, heartburns, sclerodactyly, which refers to thickening of the skin in the fingers, and telangiectasis, which refers to some capillary dilatations on the skin and on your tongue. The presence of anti-centromere antibodies in the blood is highly specific to limited cutaneous sclerosis, but it can also be seen in autoimmune diseases of the liver, such as primary biliary cirrhosis, and even in patients with lupus. Again, I cannot stress enough the fact that a positive test is not going to make the diagnosis, and you need a specialist like me or others that are trained in recognizing autoimmune diseases to make the final call. ANCA antibodies. ANCA, or anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibodies, are a group of antibodies that target certain components within the cytoplasm of neutrophils. Neutrophils are a type of white blood cells which are involved in the immune response. ANCA antibodies are associated with a group of autoimmune diseases called ANCA-associated vasculitis. There are three types of ANCA-associated vasculitis: granulomatosis with polyangiitis, GPA, which is formerly known as Wegener's granulomatosis; number two, microscopic polyangiitis, or MPA; and number three, eosinophilic granulomatosis with polyangiitis, or EGPA, which was formerly known as Chag-Strauss syndrome. Now, these types of autoimmune diseases are characterized by inflammation of the blood vessels, resulting in damage to various organs and tissues, from skin to kidneys, heart, lungs, and gastrointestinal tract. These are very serious conditions, and usually people are very sick. ANCA antibodies can be divided into two main types based on the staining patterns which are observed in the laboratory test. Number one, cytoplasmic ANCA, or c-ANCA. c-ANCA antibodies are directed against an enzyme called PR3, or proteinase 3, present in the cytoplasm of neutrophils. c-ANCA is strongly associated with GPA, perinuclear ANCA, or p-ANCA. p-ANCA antibodies are typically directed against an enzyme called MPO, or myeloperoxidase, which is found in the perinuclear region of neutrophils. p-ANCA is commonly associated with MPA and EGPA. Now, it's important to note that ANCA antibodies can also be found in other conditions, like chronic infections, people that use cocaine, and can be also induced by medications. So, they are not solely limited to this type of vasculitis. The interpretation of these ANCA results should be done together with other clinical symptoms, with imaging studies, and always by experts in rheumatology, or even by kidney specialists like a nephrologist that can be involved in treating ANCA vasculitis. Rheumatoid factor. When patients get tested with this test, rheumatoid factor, or RF, as we call it, the reason is usually to be evaluated for a type of arthritis. Have you heard about rheumatoid arthritis? This is a sneaky villain attacking your joints, especially the small joints in the hands and feet. This test can look for antibodies that target a specific part of your immune system. When these antibodies are present, it's a strong indication that rheumatoid arthritis might be lurking. However, A positive rheumatoid factor test alone is not going to make the diagnosis. I know, are you confused? Then let me explain you. A positive rheumatoid factor test means that there is a lot of inflammation in your body, which can come from rheumatoid arthritis, but also from an infection like hepatitis C. In fact, there are only 60 to 80% of people with rheumatoid arthritis that can have a positive rheumatoid factor test positive. So again, it's important to look at all the aspects, all the signs and symptoms, and not only to one test. In another video on my channel, I discuss the common causes for a positive rheumatoid factor test. So watch this video in my channel. Anti-ccp antibodies. Now, are you ready for another clue in the case of rheumatoid arthritis? Anti-ccp or anti-cyclic citrullinated peptide antibodies are autoantibodies that are commonly associated with rheumatoid arthritis. These antibodies target certain peptides, which are modified protein fragments found in the joints of people with rheumatoid arthritis. Now, the presence of anti-ccp antibodies in the blood is considered specific for rheumatoid arthritis, and it will add to the diagnosis, but also the prognosis of this condition. Why? Because the presence of anti-ccp antibodies is associated with a more severe disease, with increase in the risk of joint damage, and with a disease that can affect other organs, like your lungs, your eyes, your heart, and unfortunately, sometimes with poor response to treatment. All right, you made it. Together, we have covered the 10 most common types of autoantibodies that I use in my practice every day to diagnose people with autoimmune diseases. Not all these tests are necessary to be ordered to get the diagnosis. It is not even indicated to order all these tests if there is no clinical suspicion. Why? Because positive tests without symptoms can cause a lot of anxiety and more unnecessary tests. It is essential to remember that if you suspect an autoimmune disease or condition, Dr. Google or self-proclaimed autoimmune experts on social media may not provide you with an accurate guidance or diagnosis. Instead, try to find an experienced physician who specializes in diagnosing and treating autoimmune diseases. Find someone who has the training and is dedicated to help patients just like you. Do your research and find a specialist that will take the time and make a genuine effort to help you navigate your diagnosis, because you deserve nothing less. Through my company, Rheumatologist on Call, I had the privilege of assisting many patients across multiple US states who were questioning whether they had an autoimmune disease or not. If you need assistance, don't hesitate to visit my website, and if necessary, you can schedule an appointment from the comfort of your home. If you find this information helpful, please give a thumbs up and share it with others who may benefit from this. Leave me a comment or ask me questions, and I will try to answer to the best of my possibilities. Until next time, stay curious, stay healthy, and prioritize your education. Thank you for taking the time to watch my video. I truly appreciate it.
Rheumatologistoncall.com